Yeah, I know Thanksgiving's coming up. What am I thankful for? Blaine Gabbert, the gift of Gabbert. Bradley Pinion, the people's champ. Jaydon Mickens, I mean, that one's an obvious. Tom Brady, TB12. Well, what about you? What about you, huh? What are you thankful for? Dramatic villain intros? I don't really understand what that has to do with that.
Hello, James.
Oh. I'll call you back. What?
James, it's time for you to review the next era. Are you prepared to take your next step in your journey for hating the Tampa Bay Buccaneers?
Yes, I'm ready to review the next era. I'm going to be 100% honest with you. This is getting a little frustrating. It just seems like this team could do no right in the early stages of their formation as a team. I'm getting a little sick of this.
Excellent, James. Soon enough, you too will hate the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. The next era that you will be reviewing will be the Ray Perkins era.
Okay, Ray Perkins era, got it. Do you want me to include Richard Williamson and Vinny Testaverde in there as well? Because I'm sure I can talk about those guys at length as well.
Yes, James. It is mandatory that you talk about Vinny Testaverde as well as Richard Williamson, as they were both definitive parts of the Ray Perkins era.
Got it. Cool. I'll talk about Vinny Testaverde. I'll talk about Richard Williamson as well as Ray Perkins. Gotcha. Thanks, man. Cool. See you later.
Very good, James. I will continue to check in on your progress. Until then, farewell.
Okay. Let's go do another era. If I had to describe Ray Perkins in one word, it would be the word tough. Ray Perkins was the head coach hired after the Lehman Bennett era had ended. Remember that in last episode? That was terrible. But Ray Perkins was no stranger to being a head coach, both in the NFL and in the college level. He was recently the head coach with the New York Giants in the NFL from 1979 to 1982, where he finished with an overall record of 23 wins and 34 losses. It was nice bringing in somebody who had had some previous head coaching experience in the NFL. And I know what you're going to be saying is, wait a minute, James, that's a few years before Ray Perkins got hired. What did he do in between that time with the New York Giants and the Tampa Bay Buccaneers? Well, he actually took over for Bear Bryant at Alabama following Bear Bryant's retirement from college football. You all remember Bear Bryant, right? The greatest football coach, arguably, in the history of all of football. That guy, yeah. Ray Perkins was the guy who actually took over for him after he retired from Alabama. There's your fun fact. And he finished with a record of 32 wins, 15 losses, and one tie. And I'm going to give fair credit here. There is no way Ray Perkins could have followed up the just masterpiece, phenomenal act of coaching that Bear Bryant had. So I think that overall he did a pretty good job in the college level and a below average job in the NFL level. But the point still stands that Ray Perkins had a lot of experience both in the NFL and in the college ranks in terms of being a head coach. And if you're the guy that Alabama hires following Bear Bryant, that's a pretty good endorsement. The Ray Perkins era would officially begin in the 1987 season. And one of the biggest things for Ray Perkins was working very hard on making sure the team was disciplined. That was the number one thing of the Ray Perkins era, and really who Ray Perkins was as a coach, was he wanted to make sure that this team was disciplined. He enacted many different types of practice methods, training equipment, all these different kinds of things, some of them even being very innovative and revolutionary in terms of how the NFL would conduct practices involving equipment and other aspects of certain things that are done in practices. However, this was not always the best thing, as a lot of players and some media criticized the harshness and overall toughness of the practices and the workouts that Ray Perkins was conducting, and also the overall criticism that he was throwing at his players for, you know, not doing a good job. The 1987 offseason was also very notable for the fact that the Tampa Bay Buccaneers selected 20 players in the NFL draft. Let's go over some of the notable names. Vinny Testaverde, number one overall quarterback, was a very notable pick at the time, considering the Tampa Bay Buccaneers had never used a number one overall pick on a quarterback. Sure, they had had that pick a couple of times before, but they never used it on a quarterback. And Vinny Testaverde, former Heisman winner coming out of Miami, was a really, really important guy that the Buccaneers hedged their bets on a lot. Don't worry, we will get back to him very, very soon. Some other notable names included Ricky Reynolds, a second-round cornerback, Winston Moss, a second-round linebacker, Mark Carrier, a third-round wide receiver, Ron Hall, a fourth-round tight end, Bruce Hill, a fourth-round wide receiver, Harry Swain, a seventh-round offensive lineman, Greg Davis, a ninth-round kicker, who, by the way, fun fact on Greg Davis, 67th most points in NFL history, and fun fact on Harry Swain, a three-time Super Bowl winner, not with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, and same thing with Greg Davis. Both those guys didn't play for the Buccaneers that much at all, but I just wanted to put them on here because they had some very interesting tidbits when researching their careers. But going into the 1987 season, it ended with a 4-11 record, and one of the biggest stories coming out of this season was the Buccaneers lost a lot of close games. Another interesting story was that there was a player strike, and a lot of the NFL teams had to use a lot of replacement players. It was really a dark year for the league as a whole. The Tampa Bay Buccaneers scored 286 points and they allowed 360 points. Not a great point differential. I feel like I have seen this before. But one more important thing to note about this team in 1987 was that they were insanely young guys. I think the average age was somewhere around 24 to 25 years old. That just kind of gives you an idea of what Ray Perkins was working with in his first year. But kind of taking a little bit more of a look at some notable stats from some of the guys, Steve DeBerg was still the quarterback, and don't worry, he has quite an interesting history in these years of the Ray Perkins era and Richard Williamson era. Don't worry, I'll explain that part later. But Steve DeBerg and Vinny Testaverde both shared time at the quarterback position during this season. They were 230 out of 440 passing. That is good for a 52.3 completion percentage, 19 touchdowns to 13 interceptions. Not the best touchdown to interception ratio, but don't worry, it's going to get a whole lot worse. The main starting two running backs were James Wilder and Jeff Smith. James Wilder, 106 attempts, 488 yards, 0 touchdowns, 40 receptions, 328 yards, 1 touchdown. Just the playing time continued to devolve more and more for James Wilder, and that would basically continue to be the case until he retired, unfortunately. But Jeff Smith, 100 attempts, 309 yards, 2 touchdowns. He also had 20 receptions for 197 yards and 2 touchdowns. The main wide receiver was still Gerald Carter. Remember him from the Lehman Bennett era? He had 38 receptions, 586 yards, and 5 touchdowns. Not the best, but that is kind of a sign of the times. It was definitely more of a running league back in the late 80s, early 90s. Also, Calvin McGee and Mark Carrier did some very interesting things. We will get back to Mark Carrier as well. Don't worry, that's kind of more of a positive thing. But on the defensive side of the football, defensive end Ron Holmes would finish the year with 8 sacks and 1 fumble recovered. Right outside linebacker Chris Washington also finished with 6.5 sacks. Not bad numbers considering, everything that happened that year. Also, defensive back Paul Tripoli finished with 3 interceptions, 1 touchdown, and 3 fumbles recovered. Pretty good year for that defensive back. And then finally, cornerback Ricky Reynolds finished with 2 forced fumbles, which we will see kind of be a main theme for Ricky Reynolds during his time with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. He was one of the more lone bright spots of the team during this era. Now we move forward to the 1988 season, and the Buccaneers did lose some players between 1987 and 1988, one of the main ones being Steve DeBerg. The era has officially ended for now. Steve DeBerg was traded to Kansas City for a player who I will talk about here in a little bit. They also lost quarterbacks coach Mark Trestman. That's right, Mark Trestman used to be the quarterbacks coach for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Remember when he was, awful with the Chicago Bears? Yeah, he got one of his main gigs starting with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Fun fact. Also, they lost wide receiver Gerald Carter, and they lost defensive back Paul Tripoli. Unfortunately, they lost a couple of pretty good guys. Now, here's one thing I do want to make a note of. Mike Shula, son of Don Shula, legendary head coach for the Baltimore Colts, among the, Miami Dolphins when he kind of went undefeated. He's kind of one of the best coaches in the history of the NFL, but his son, Mike Shula, played quarterback at Alabama, was a 12th round draft pick in the 1987 NFL draft. Ray Perkins and him obviously had a history together. I didn't talk about him in the 1987 season because he didn't make the roster. But the interesting thing that I want to point out here was while he didn't make the roster, he was hired as an offensive assistant in the 1988 season, 24 years old, and he was now in charge of helping coach Vinny Testaverde, who was 7 months older than him. That's kind of one of the main stories of this Ray Perkins era, was he had one of the main responsibilities of helping coach, basically by himself, Vinny Testaverde, the guy who was supposed to be the golden ticket to the Buccaneers' relevancy in the late 80s and early 90s. It was basically just up to Ray Perkins and a little bit of Richard Williamson, but that was certainly a tough task, and I just thought it was interesting that Mike Shula was helping out with that whenever, Vinny Testaverde was a little bit older than him, and they were both only 24 years old. That was just an interesting fact that I wanted to point out here. But the 1988 NFL draft featured a lot of good players for the Buccaneers. Some of the names include Paul Gruber, left tackle, who they drafted in round number one, who is one of the best players in Buccaneers history. Lawrence Tate was a running back drafted in round two. William Howard was a running back drafted in round five. Reuben Davis was a defensive end drafted in round nine. However, all this talent and all the hope that the Buccaneers had would not come to pass as they finished with a 5-11 record. More harsh treatment of players from Ray Perkins, more criticism being thrown towards the head coach's way. Things were not going well. Players were not happy. Fans were not happy. The media was a little bit questioning things more and more as time went on. And Ray Perkins, being Ray Perkins, just said, "I don't really care." But they still continued to lose a lot of close games yet again. However, they did have a top five run defense, which I thought was very interesting. They scored 261 points in the 1988 season, but they gave up 350 points. Again, not a great differential, but they were still a very young team that was still trying to build things up. So there still was some hope for a lot of guys in the future. Some of the more interesting stats here: Vinny Testaverde was your starting quarterback, now with Steve DeBerg gone. 222 of 466 passing, 3,240 passing yards, and 13 touchdowns to 35 interceptions. That's, I don't even need to tell you how bad that is. That's mythically bad. That's historically bad. I think that's the most interceptions in Buccaneers history. I think that record still stands. I know Jameis Winston got close when he had 30 interceptions, but that record's never going to be broken. 35 interceptions in 1 year. That's insane. I can't even make like a joke or some witty comment about that. That is so freaking bad. Vinny Testaverde, what were you doing? But some of the other stats: Lawrence Tate, the running back, 122 attempts, 467 yards, 7 touchdowns, 5 receptions, 23 yards, and a touchdown as well receiving. William Howard, 115 attempts, 452 yards, and 1 touchdown. James Wilder did not play a lot this year due to injuries and some other stuff that really just prevented him from playing. It was very unfortunate that his career was really winding down in terms of just being injury riddled and not seeing a lot of playing time, but that's just the way it went, unfortunately. Wide receiver Hill, 58 receptions, 1,040 receiving yards, and 9 touchdowns. And Mark Carrier, hey, 57 receptions, 970 passing yards, and 5 touchdowns as well. Ron Hall, 39 receptions, 550 receiving yards. The receiving core of these three guys, of Bruce Hill, Mark Carrier, and Ron Hall, were a good trio of pass catchers. I mean, Vinny Testaverde had the weapons, and the yardage was up there, and the touchdowns were up there. Just maybe, Vinny, you know, it already happened, so we can't talk about it. But Vinny T, man, buddy, maybe you should have just thrown less interceptions and, you know, the team might have won more. Just a thought. It's just a thought. You know, for any quarterback out there who may be watching this video, just throw less interceptions and things might go a little bit better for you. On the defensive side of the football, though, Ron Holmes was back with 4 sacks. Harry Hamilton, 6 interceptions, and Ricky Reynolds, the cornerback, had 4 interceptions in his own right. Ricky Reynolds was having a good start to his career. Harry Hamilton kind of came out of nowhere, and Ron Holmes continued to do some pretty decent things on defense. So the pieces were there in 1988 for success, both on offense and defense, but now we go to the 1989 season. We move on to the 1989 season, basically the same team from the 1988 season. Unfortunately, this would be James Wilder's last year with the team. It really did suck to see him go and retire, but I think overall he did have a great career with the Buccaneers while he was with the team, and I still think he should be in the Ring of Honor. I think he will be very soon. But the draft from the 1988-89 offseason included guys like Broderick Thomas, a linebacker who was drafted in the first round, and Chris Moore, punter, who was drafted in round number 6. And that was the two notable guys from the 1989 NFL draft. Not good. Not good at all, considering that 13 total guys were drafted, and there were only 2 guys who had any semblance of a career with the Buccaneers. This was arguably the worst year of drafting in the Ray Perkins, Richard Williamson era. This, by far, the 89 draft was not the best. I mean, Broderick Thomas was good. We will talk about him. And Chris Moore, a punter in round 6. I mean, but 13 players drafted. You only get 2 guys who are notable for their careers. Not the best draft ever. But they did finish with a 5-11 record yet again in the 1989 season. Less close games, more blowouts happened, so it seemed like they were losing their cohesion a little bit in terms of being a team that was fighting every single game. More criticism being thrown at Ray Perkins, by the way, because he just continued to just throw just criticism towards his players and the team as a whole. And why was he doing this? Like, why? It wasn't a good thing. He is just being a jerk. Like, it doesn't accomplish anything. It just makes your players hate you. That's not how you do things. But a lot of people did think that this team was better than its record. So yet again, there was still hope for Ray Perkins that he would be able to turn things around with the players that he had at his disposal. Let's dive into some of the stats. Vinny Testaverde, 258 of 480 passing, 3,133 passing yards, 20 touchdowns to 22 interceptions. Man, this Vinny Testaverde career is really getting off to the right track here. Way better than the 1988 season, by the way, but still has more interceptions than touchdowns. That's not fun. I think that's the 3rd year in a row that that had happened for Vinny Testaverde. He played sparingly in year 1 with Steve DeBerg. Year 2 was freaking awful. And now in year 3, he's still throwing more interceptions than touchdowns. Vinny T, buddy, please clean up the interceptions. Please, I beg of you. James Wilder, 335 receiving yards, 3 touchdowns in his final year. He really didn't have any rushing stats worth of note. Lars Tate was back as the starting running back, 167 attempts, 589 yards, 8 touchdowns, 11 receptions, 75 yards, and 1 touchdown. William Howard, 108 attempts, 357 yards, 1 touchdown, 30 receptions, 188 yards, and a touchdown as well. Mark Carrier, 86 receptions, 1,422 receiving yards, and 9 touchdowns. A receiving yardage record that would not be broken until Mike Evans broke it just a couple of years ago. By the way, Shout out to Mark Carrier. He was off to a very impressive start to his Tampa Bay Buccaneers and just NFL career in general. Bruce Hill, 50 receptions, 673 receiving yards, and 5 touchdowns. On the defensive side of the football, Kevin Murphy, outside linebacker, 6 sacks, 2 fumbles recovered. Winston Moss, 5.5 sacks at the outside linebacker position. Safety Mark Robinson, who was a part of that Steve DeBerg trade. I told you that we would get back to that player. He finished the year with 6 interceptions, 3 forced fumbles, and 2.5 sacks. Harry Hamilton was back with 6 interceptions and a fumble recovered, and Ricky Reynolds had 5 interceptions, a touchdown, 2 fumbles recovered, and 2 fumbles forced. So this secondary was putting up amazing numbers. The defense was getting some players who were productive in pass rushing. The running game did leave a little bit left to be desired, but the wide receiver core was making some great plays. There's just one problem. Vinny Testaverde was still throwing interceptions, and it was not fun, and this team was starting to crumble a little bit, regardless of the stats. To the 1990 season, and this one was a doozy. There was more noise from fans and players, yet again, on the bad conditions in practice. Ray Perkins just continued. He wouldn't stop throwing criticism on players and on the team for their work conditions and all these types of things. He called players lazy. He said that they weren't even playing like a football team. It was so bad and frustrating for players and fans alike, and the pressure was on for this season for Ray Perkins. If he couldn't prove that he was turning this team around with all the talent that he had at his disposal, then things could potentially change. The Buccaneers lost James Wilder, Lars Tate, and William Howard in the offseason, their entire running back core for the past couple of years. But in the NFL draft, they did get a lot of help. Keith McCants, defensive end in round number 1, Reggie Cobb, running back in round number 2, Tony Mayberry, center in round number 4. Remember him? He was a great player for the Buccaneers. Ian Beckles, guard in round number 5. Overall, a very solid draft. That's one thing I will give to Ray Perkins, was he had some very solid drafts minus 1989, but overall, I thought that he was able to get a lot of really good talent that set up the Buccaneers for a few years down the line, in some cases many years down the line, in terms of having solid pieces at solid position groups. So, good job to Ray Perkins for that. But the Buccaneers would finish this year with a 6-10 record, more lopsided losses, and that's the end of the Ray Perkins era. He finished after a 5-8 start, where he would then be fired before the final 3 games of the season, and he would be replaced by Richard Williamson, who was serving as Ray Perkins' offensive coordinator at the time. And I will talk about Richard Williamson in this Ray Perkins era video, because I'm kind of just adding them both together, because really it was kind of a joint operation. Richard Williamson was with Ray Perkins pretty much his entire time as head coach of the Buccaneers. He succeeded him right after Ray Perkins. It makes sense that I would have these guys bunched together here. But Vinny Testaverde finished 203 of 365 passing, 2,818 passing yards, 17 touchdowns to 18 interceptions. Again, he threw more interceptions than touchdowns. You are not going to win football games when you do that. Gary Anderson, starting running back, 166 attempts, 646 rushing yards, 3 touchdowns, 38 receptions, 464 yards, 2 receiving touchdowns. Overall, pretty decent season by Gary Anderson. Reggie Cobb, the rookie, 151 attempts, 480 rushing yards, 2 touchdowns, 39 receptions, 299 receiving yards. Mark Carrier was still doing Mark Carrier things, 49 receptions, 813 yards, and 4 touchdowns. He really was the best player of this era, I think. I'm pretty sure, hands down, maybe minus a couple of other guys on the defensive side of the football, but on the offensive side of the football, Mark Carrier was that dude. Going a little bit deeper, Bruce Hill, 42 receptions, 641 yards, and 5 touchdowns. Ron Hall, 31 receptions, 464 yards, and 2 touchdowns. So at least that receiving trio was still there of Hill, Carrier, and Hall. I like all three of those guys, and I think they all did a very good job during the Ray Perkins era until, you know, it all eventually came crashing down. On the defensive side of the football, Broderick Thomas, 7.5 sacks, 2 forced fumbles, 2 fumbles recovered, not a bad year at all. Irvin Randall, inside linebacker, had 5.5 sacks. Good for him to finally jump into the picture here. Cornerback Wayne Haddix made the Pro Bowl this year, so at least the Bucs had that going for them. 7 interceptions, 3 touchdowns. Great job, Wayne Haddix, by the way, for making the Pro Bowl. That's the first time the Buccaneers had a Pro Bowl player make that event in many, many years. So good job, Wayne Haddix, for that. Harry Hamilton had 5 interceptions, 2 fumbles recovered. Mark Robinson was back with 4 interceptions, and Ricky Reynolds had 3 interceptions and 2 fumbles recovered as well. So this secondary was set. I mean, they were phenomenal. The pass rush was still good. Rushing game, you know, swapped a lot of guys out, but they were still getting some things going. The receiving trio stayed the same through many years so far up to this point. Let's see what Richard Williamson could do in the 1991 season after taking over for Ray Perkins. It didn't go good. The 1991 season was Richard Williamson's now full-time head coach season. Hugh Culverhouse was in a lot of trouble, by the way, because it had been basically revealed, I guess, that Hugh Culverhouse was letting players go into free agency, leave the Tampa Bay Buccaneers so he could save money for himself. I mean, Hugh Culverhouse being a greedy NFL owner, I just don't buy that at all. But the Buccaneers did lose a lot of players in the offseason. Irvin Randall, inside linebacker. Winston Moss, inside linebacker. Wayne Haddix, cornerback, was gone by midseason. And Mark Robinson, the safety, was gone as well. So much talent on the defensive side of the football was gone, and that stung. Like, that stung a lot. I mean, it makes me feel pain now in 2020 to know that those guys had left the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, considering what they had done for the Buccaneers in years past, and they were gone, and that sucked. But the NFL draft did bring in yet again some more reinforcements, especially on the offensive side of the football, as Charles McRae was a tackle drafted in round number 1. Lawrence Dossie was a wide receiver drafted in round number 3. Don't worry, we will get back to him. And Marty Carter was a cornerback drafted in round number 8. However, nobody the Buccaneers could have added could have saved them, as they finished with a 3-13 record, and Richard Williamson was fired after his first season. So, good job, Hugh Culverhouse. You really brought in a guy who could succeed and take over for Ray Perkins and do a great job, Richard Williamson, right? No, 3-13 record is terrible, and 199 points scored for the Buccaneers offense and 365 points given up as a team. Not good. I mean, even Ray Perkins was having better point differentials than what we saw there. That was Lehman Bennett era stuff. I mean, just horrible, horrible results. I mean, literally, that's Lehman Bennett type stuff. Vinny Testaverde would finish with 166 of 326 passing, 1,994 passing yards, 8 touchdowns to 15 interceptions. And I do want to point out that ever since the Buccaneers had drafted Vinny Testaverde, they benched him multiple times throughout his NFL career with the Buccaneers. Multiple times during the Ray Perkins and Richard Williamson era. It started off as 1-2 games a year, and then this year it was for, I believe, 4 or 5 games. So they had just lost basically all hope in Vinny Testaverde for him to do anything to be a franchise quarterback for this team. It was really unfortunate, and I will talk about it more here in a second, but yeah, Vinny Testaverde got benched a lot. They never really had full confidence in Vinny T as a quarterback, and it was very unfortunate to see. But running back Reggie Cobb finished with 196 attempts, 752 yards, 7 touchdowns, 15 receptions, and 111 receiving yards, so at least the running game was improved from years past. Wide receiver Lawrence Dossey, I told you we'd get back to him. 55 receptions, 818 receiving yards, and 3 receiving touchdowns. Not a bad year at all. Mark Carrier, 47 receptions, 698 yards, and 2 touchdowns. I do want to make a point that Bruce Hill was still on the team. He was just dealing with some injuries and some other stuff that prevented him from playing, which was unfortunate to see there. Tight end Ron Hall, 31 receptions, 284 yards. So that receiving core was hit very, very hard with Bruce Hill being hurt, not being able to play. You know, Mark Carrier having a down year, Ron Hill having a down year. But Lawrence Dossey was there, which made things a little bit more bearable. On the defensive side of the football, Broderick Thomas had a really, really good year. 11 sacks, 7, count them, 7 forced fumbles. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 forced fumbles and 2 fumbles recovered. Great year by Broderick Thomas. The best pass rushing year a Buccaneers player had seen since Leroy Selman's great days. So, you know, hey, good job to, you know, Broderick Thomas for that. Defensive end Dexter Manley had 6.5 sacks and 1 fumble recovered. Defensive end Keith McCants, remember him, he had 5 sacks and 1 fumble recovered. Defensive tackle Tim Newton, 5 sacks, 2 fumbles recovered. On the secondary, Tony Covington, 3 interceptions, 1 fumble recovered, 1 sack. And Ricky Reynolds, 2 interceptions, 1 fumble recovered, and 1 sack. So the secondary still had some good pieces, not as good as in years past. The pass rush was still doing good, but the offense just took a dip. Just a terrible, terrible dip. And that was it. I mean, that was pretty much it for the Ray Perkins, Richard Williamson era. What can we learn from this? So what happened, right? Like, why did Ray Perkins and Richard Williamson fail as head coaches for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers? Well, to get Richard Williamson out of the way first, just wasn't a good hire by Hugh Culverhouse. That guy just wasn't going to be a good head coach in the NFL. He was just riding the coattails of Ray Perkins. But Ray Perkins was such a more interesting case, in my opinion. I mean, the guy took over for Bear Bryant at Alabama, and he had been a former head coach with the Giants, where he had orchestrated a little bit of a rebuild, a little bit of a turnaround, where he brought the Giants to a pretty respectable team after a couple of years. So I don't think that Ray Perkins was an overall bad hire by Hugh Culverhouse. I respect the idea of what Ray Perkins was trying to do when he came to the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. I mean, following the Lehman Bennett era, this team needed somebody who was going to come in and discipline these players and make sure that these guys were conditioned and ready to play football. And that was Ray Perkins' main MO. He wanted to make sure that this team was going to be a football team and they were going to be ready to play every single time, and that they weren't going to slack around like we had seen in the Lehman Bennett era. I respect that idea, and I think that is a good goal to have as a head coach, but you need to have limits with these things. I will never be a head coach in my entire life, by the way. I will never, ever be an NFL head coach, but in my opinion, I feel that if you are trying to build a team and you are trying to connect with people and get people to play with you and show leadership, it's not good if you're trying to rule over them and criticize them year after year after year and keep on telling them that they are not doing good enough, that they are out of shape, that they are not conditioned, and that they are not playing like an NFL team. If you keep on doing those things, one, it's not going to have a good effect on the psyche of your players. They are going to think that they are always not good enough. Two, it's going to make your players not like you. I understand that some players do like to be motivated like that, and I do understand that, kind of drive and things like that, but I think that overall players just wouldn't want to play for a head coach who is constantly criticizing them and saying that they are never good enough and not good enough to be on an NFL team. I mean, that's just not good. We saw the criticism from fans. We saw the criticism from players. It was one of the main reasons to why players leaving the Tampa Bay Buccaneers during these years, because they had had enough of Ray Perkins and just his constant criticism of this team. So we've seen that before in the NFL, where guys come from highly, you know, touted coaching careers and college ranks. I know that Ray Perkins had been an NFL coach, then joined the college ranks, but he came from college and he tried to basically treat this team like a college team, and you can't do that in the NFL. These are fully grown professional athletes making a ton of money. You can't sit there and treat them like college kids. That's not going to work. We have really never seen that work too well in the NFL, maybe minus a couple of instances at that. So, you know, while there were a ton of great players on this team, it really boiled down to just Ray Perkins just not necessarily having the right mindset, or I guess going overboard with the right mindset that really doomed him as a head coach. Another big thing that was a main staple of the Ray Perkins and a little bit of the Richard Williamson era was Vinny Testaverde, who finished these years, by the way, with a 19-39 record, 12,266 passing yards, 63 touchdowns, and 96 interceptions. However, he was sacked 162 times. That's 42 times a season on average. And he was benched multiple times. The coaching staff clearly had no faith in Vinny Testaverde pretty much from the get-go. I mean, they would have been better off keeping Steve DeBerg and just playing the veteran quarterback. Now, I do feel bad for Vinny Testaverde. It wasn't his fault necessarily that he was getting sacked 42 times a year, which is a darn shame because the Buccaneers drafted some good offensive linemen. I mean, Charles McRae, Tony Mayberry, Paul Gruber, those are three very solid starting offensive linemen, and I feel he had a great wide receiver core around him, and he had a little bit of a running game with James Wilder towards the end of his career, and also guys like Lars Tate, Richard Williamson, among some other guys like Reggie Cobb. I mean, the running backs seemed to be there a little bit. The wide receiver core was certainly there. You even had a couple of good receiving tight ends in Ron Hall, among others. It was just a really unfortunate thing that things didn't work out for Vinny Testaverde. I know a lot of people were invested and wanted to see Vinny T succeed. I don't blame you guys. I mean, it was a very monumental thing that the Buccaneers did in drafting him number one overall at the quarterback position. First time they had ever done that as a franchise, but it didn't work out for Ray Perkins. It didn't work out for Vinny Testaverde. It didn't work out for Richard Williamson. And this was just yet another dark period in Buccaneers history and a lot of what could have been's. You know, that was, I think, the main story and the main narrative of the Ray Perkins, Richard Williamson, Vinny Testaverde era was, you know, this team could have been so much better if just a couple of things were changed. I mean, they had the talent on offense and on defense. They really did have the talent, but things just didn't work out.
Okay, yeah, that sucked. I mean, that team had so much potential for so many years, and it was just wasted. God, that is frustrating.
James, how do you feel after reviewing the Ray Perkins era?
Yeah, that was a frustrating one. I'm not gonna lie. That might be the most frustrating one you have given me yet. And I'm not gonna lie, man, this is starting to get kind of annoying.
Good, James. It's that anger and frustration that will finally drive you into hating this team and understanding what it truly is, a terrible NFL franchise.
Look, buddy, I don't care. I'm gonna keep on fighting. I'm gonna keep on moving. I'm gonna keep on knocking out these eras, and I am going to stop you no matter what. You cannot break me.
Don't worry, James. Soon you will come to see my point of view. Until then, I will have your next era for you soon. But for now, farewell.
Jeez, this is really getting tough.